and hope that everyone is relaxed and got a drink in their hand and having a relaxed moment. And we'll go through cybersecurity, which is a topic which is important to us today in the world today where we live. And before we jump into the topic, I wanted to ask everyone that if you have any questions or any thoughts, any areas that you would like to explore, then you put that through on the either the chat window or in the Q&A window, and I'll make sure that we cover that off during the session. So please feel free, because if the more questions that you share, everybody shares, the more value that we can get from this 1 hour that we have together. We will wind up by 8 p.m. And if there are any more questions after that or any other discussions, then happy to hang on. Internet of Things, and some questions around personal security as well coming in. So I'll cover them off as we go along, if that's okay. So today's session, we will try to keep it at a level where we don't get into any technical jargon, and we'll try to keep it at a level where we are thinking around day-to-day things that we do, which either create risk or they are helping us to protect ourselves. So those would be the areas of concern. And obviously, I think everybody is familiar with the role of technology and why that's creating risk for security. So we have a few polls as well during the session, and that will allow all of us to look at what type of concerns we have or what type of questions we have or what type of security posture that we do. The session is more focused on personal aspects of security, but also there's an element of what should we do at work, which will allow us to protect ourselves and as well as our workplaces. And if there's any other area that you want to explore, things like how do I, my workplace, or if you have a specific requirement, like for example, if you think that at your workplace, which may be a business of, for example, say if you are working in healthcare, then what kind of cybersecurity challenges and solutions are coming through? So happy to address some of those as well. Although the material that I will share today will be more focused on personal actions that we can take. So if that's okay, as I said, happy to explore all the areas of cybersecurity that may be of interest to everyone on the session today. So let's move on then. The first thing I'll do is I'll have a small poll that will help us to get started. So the first question would be, where are we located today? Where are we coming in from? And let me just open up this poll. I'll open this up for about 60 seconds so that we can get a sense of our locations. And the location is important to the extent that we get to see different cybersecurity challenges in different locations as well. So I'll open the poll now. Here we go. I hope everybody was able to see the poll. And you can see responses coming through. There are about 40% response rate. About 50% now, 60%, about 70%. A couple of more people left. So close the poll in about 10 seconds. If everybody has responded, then we'll close the poll now. Okay. So I'll share the results with everyone, and then we can see where we are. So are you able to see the results? You can see that there are most of the people are from the south, staying in the south part of the country. And interestingly, there are some no answers as well, which means that they probably are in the cyber world somewhere and probably joined to trouble us a little bit. Of course, everybody's, and there's none of the above, which means that it looks like that everybody is either inside India or outside India. So with that, we'll move to the next part of the discussion, and I'll close the polling. Okay, so I'm using this tool perhaps for the first time. So is everyone able to see the screen again, or is the poll question still open? And Sushma, are you able to see the screen again? Yes, okay, great. Thank you very much. I've got some responses. So that helps us to helps us to move on. And so the first set of information I wanted to share was that, look, the reason location is perhaps a little bit important, not always, because people from different parts of the country or world can do all sorts of things to us. But importantly, it seems that there are some parts of the country where, according to the crime statistics, so this is the statistics from the National Crime Bureau, it appears that there are some states where more cybercrime cases are reported. And not surprisingly, the most popular states are the highest cybercrime states. So if you are based out of one of these states like Uttar Pradesh or Maharashtra, of course, many people would be in Karnataka because they're in Bangalore. These are the top three states where cybercrime is reported from. What this means is that we need to be more careful if we are in these areas. It doesn't mean that we should not be careful if we are outside, but it looks like that there are more people who are interested in doing criminal activity from these states for various reasons. Now, how does India stack up against the rest of the world? I think we know that the biggest risk countries are perhaps United States. And so here we can see that although US and China are big, here it looks like that India has got a significant amount of in the top 20 countries. India does come up, and this is primarily from the perspective of the value of cyber crimes rather than the incidents. In terms of incidents, India is fairly highly ranked, perhaps in the top three cyber criminal incidents. So there is a significant challenge that we do face today in terms of cybersecurity because of the fact that everybody is connected to the internet, and there are machines now which will attack us. So very much like if you can imagine the scene from one of the movies, like, for example, Matrix, where there were machines which were attacking us, and they can come in from every little hole that is there in our lives. So for example, if our house has got any small hole, a virus can come in from the air. Similarly, if we leave a small hole in our phone, or if we leave a small, literally a hole in our laptop, then people can attack us and get in there and then steal things and do bad things to us. So that's the context of this thing. Everybody knows that. So without further ado, let me just ask another question, which may be worth thinking about. So there are some examples here of what can happen. if there is a criminal attack on someone. So it could be money that is lost. So there are, I think everybody would have heard of instances where money is lost, instances of where laptops are locked down, Facebook accounts are hacked into and defaced and they're used for bad things like posting abuses. Company accounts are hacked. So for example, if I work for a company like, for example, work for Airtel or for State Bank of India, my account is hacked and through my account, the attacker can do bad things to other people in the company or post some confidential information out and then I can get into trouble through that. Of course, my mobile phone can get lost and it has got a lot of information about me, including all my passwords, and that can be a nightmare situation as well. So let's ask ourselves, what is the worst of these? So again, another poll, and then we can then get into this description of some of these. So there's a poll here. I'm going to open up again, and then if you could provide your responses, and we'll close it again in about 1 minute. So what is your worst scenario about out of these five? Okay, we've got some responses coming in. We're about halfway through. Yeah, you can take some time if you want to think about it. We're about 60% of the way through. And we've got about 10 seconds left, so you can share your responses. We're about 80% of the way through. Okay, we're going to close the poll in a few seconds. So here we go. Close the poll now. Okay. Just waiting for participants to submit responses. Okay. So the results are coming up. And I'll share the results in just a moment for you. So poll results. Slide. Okay, so here we go. So are you able to see the results now? We can see that 8% for A, 12% for B, 4% for C, 25% for D, 21% for E, and then a few no answers as well. So from among these, it appears that people are really concerned that if my company account is lost and things bad things happen through that, then I can get in trouble. So that's a real nightmare scenario because that can happen, and all it needs is that somebody knows how my email ID, how my account ID is structured, and if they can just keep doing a lot of what is called brute force attacks, which means they can keep trying all sorts of passwords, then it is possible that within probably about a few minutes or maybe even a few days, they can get into my account. And then, of course, if I have access to hundreds of systems for my company, if I, for example, have access to changing things into my company's servers and in applications, for example, if you're a system administrator, then you have vast amount of access, and that can be a nightmare. Or somebody steals information from my email and posts it on the websites or on the dark web, then there's leakage of data, and that can be a nightmare. So yes, that is a real nightmare situation if my company account is hacked. And certainly my phone, I think that's the right thing to think about, is that there's so much information on the phone that if it gets lost, then I think that I can be very distressed about it. And so what can we do about it? Those are the type of questions. I think the other things, which is money getting transferred from my account, I think perhaps people are concerned about that. At the same time, there are laws in the country now which allow us to If we know, if we get to know about it, and within 3 days, if we tell the bank that this is not a transaction I've done, then the law protects us from having to face that loss. And the bank, if they are notified within a certain amount of time, and as per the law, then they'll credit the money back to us. So that there is some protection around that in terms of the banks. Laptop locked down by ransomware, that's a nightmare again if I don't have backup of the data, but still it is a limited amount of risk that is there. And then fake Facebook account, this has happened to many people, but I suppose we don't necessarily worry about it because Facebook can change things for us. It's not an irreversible problem. So rightly so, the right level of concerns. I'll shut this poll now and then we'll move on. Okay, so I hope everyone can see the screen back, and we'll move quickly to the next page. And we have some examples now of things that we just talked about, laptops and things like that. So the first one is some information. So there have been many, many fraud cases of online banking. So in this, according to this data, government data, RBI data, Reserve Bank of India. There have been 25,000 cases, and it appears that several hundred crores have been lost in that process. So there's a fair number of cases that happen, and there's on an average about 6 lakh rupees which are lost through this through these online banking frauds. And that's a significant amount, and some people have lost 30,000, 40,000, some people have lost several lakhs of rupees, 35, 40 lakhs of rupees as well. And some very ingenious ways in which these frauds have happened. For example, as you would have heard, that for example somebody clones the SIM card. So if I have a SIM card, somebody clones my SIM card, and using that they will get the OTP onto their phone, and using that OTP, if they have my account number, they'll be able to change my password, and then once they change the password, they can set up another beneficiary, transfer the money. By the time I get to know, it's too late and I've lost a lot of money. So what's happened today is that all the banking security has been transferred to telecom companies. So they are the ones who are responsible for our security, our banking security, because they send us OTPs, and that's how our security works in the banking situation today. And so we have to be careful about if we see any suspicious messages coming out into our phones, we have to be very careful and be alert and talking to our banks as well. So there are several cases, 25,000 cases last year, and only increasing. The next case is where there has been identity theft. So as we know, that so much information about us is available everywhere. So everywhere we go, people say, give me your identity proof. So I go and check into a bank, into a hotel, give me an identity proof. So I give them very happily either my Aadhaar card, or I offer them my driving license or PAN card. They'll take a copy of that. Now, what happens to that? Nobody knows. So it's quite easy today to get hold of one person's all this information: PAN card, Aadhaar number, DL, driving license, address, telephone number, all of these things. And once somebody knows all of these things about me, then, for example, in this case, this person found that there was a fraudster who was impersonating him, somebody called Rajesh, and had applied for loans with many, many companies in his name. And that is a nightmare situation, because then my credit score goes for a toss, and if, for example, they're given a large amount of money, then I can be in trouble. So identity theft is a very high risk in our country, because we keep getting asked for so many of our documents. So one of the recommendations that comes through is that whenever we give people this information, we should always write on it, hey, this is for this purpose, and hence it should not be used for any other purposes. So they could actually use some of this information for creating a new, for example, an account or a SIM card. They can issue a SIM card in my name by giving a copy of my PAN ID. So that those kind of things become very difficult. So we have to be very careful, and there's not much that we can do about it, but at the same time, we have to be very, very watchful of who we give these things to. The next case we will have a quick chat about is regarding ransomware. So we've all heard of the cases of Petya and WannaCry. And these are cases where, and there have been cases where, for example, as we know, large companies have had to have had their laptops and their servers locked up. And for example, a company like Merck, which is a big pharmaceutical company, they incurred $300 million of loss due to this ransomware attack. $300 million of loss was incurred by Merck. There were shipping companies which couldn't put their ships out. A organization like National Health Service of the UK, they had to shut down for several hours. And then, of course, there is money to be paid for this ransomware. There was an interesting case of ransomware where, if you are into this business, you could probably be victimized by this. So there was a case where, this is a case in Europe, in Austria. There was a small hotel. They had about 25-30 rooms. This was a hotel which catered to people in the skiing industry or the skiing business, and people come and ski. And this hotel had converted to a electronic locking system, and suddenly they were attacked by ransomware, and all their hotel rooms were locked out. And the ransomware attacker said, "Look, unless you give me so much money in bitcoins, I will not unlock them." And the guests were all waiting. They come back from skiing. They couldn't get into their rooms. And here is a nightmare situation for a hotel owner, is that their guests who come back from a long day, they can't get into their rooms. And so they quickly had to transfer 10,000 euros worth of ransomware, Bitcoin ransomware, to this attacker. And then they managed to open their rooms. And then, of course, these guys then finally ended up changing all the locks as well. So such things happen. We know that. And if our systems are not secure, which we'll talk a little bit about as to how to secure systems, then these attacks can happen to anybody. There have been individuals who've been asked to pay $500, $1,000, and it seems that these guys have made probably about almost $1 billion by these ransomware attacks. And these attacks can happen to anybody, as we know. So ransomware attacks are a big challenge today, and we'll talk about how we protect ourselves from that. So feel free to, if you have any thoughts around this, happy to please do share. And then the next discussion is around social media. So a very sad story of a teenage person who ended her life as a result of being victimized and bullied on social media. And this can happen to anybody. This is really, really very, very easy for people to do, is that they can take a very, very bad picture of somebody, like, for example, a nude picture of me, and they could easily, or a nude picture of somebody else, and they could easily Photoshop my face on it. And then after that, if they hack my Facebook account, they could easily put it on my account. And that would be a nightmare for me, for example. And if this is replicated, then where do we go? And of course, Facebook will change things, but at the same time, the mental scars that remain for a very long time. So we have to be careful. So what do we do about this? What we do about this is that we keep passwords safely and those kind of things. So and we don't post too much of our information on the social media. So such things are happening, as we know. And if God forbid some of these things happen to people that you know, then we have to support them in the right sort of way. And not really, become the perpetrators of the victim as well. So here are some examples of what kind of situations people are facing today. And there are, of course, there are many, many others, and we can go on. But I suppose we all know these situations that people have gone through. I think there's some questions that somebody has asked about industrial automation and IoT. So in that context, there have been cases, for example, if everybody might be aware of, for example, There was a denial of service attacks. Now, what is denial of service? It means that if I have a website, for example, if I am, let's say, Flipkart.com, and customers come to my website to buy a lot of goods, then somebody can be, my website can handle a certain amount of number of visitors. So, it's, for example, my website, Flipkart website can handle, say, for example, 1 billion visitors, like it, because it's India, so they can handle 1 billion visitors. But suddenly, if they start getting 10 billion visitors, then the website will not be able to function because there's too many people who are trying to enter to the website. Now, what happened in one of the cases was that, as I think many people would know, is that in the US, there was a university which had many, obviously all universities or every large organization will have many devices like routers and these kind of devices, cameras, which are all over the campus, and these are connected to the internet. So they've got IP addresses, they're connected to the internet. And someone managed to hack into these, and I'll describe how they hacked into it in a moment, but they hacked into these, they took control over all these devices, and there were thousands of these devices, and they converted them into what are called just zombie kind of robots type of devices, and started sending millions of these pings or requests to websites. Somebody's mentioning that you cannot hear me. Is that the case? Are people able to hear me? Okay. All right. Thanks, Vivek. So there we go. So there was a large organization, all their IoT devices, as these are called Internet of Things devices, which means devices like your routers, your cameras, your CCTV cameras, they were all hacked and used for launching what is called a denial of service attack on many organizations. And this is in the context of the IoT. So we'll move on to the next one. So such things are happening, and what we need to do around these, we will have a discussion around this in a few moments. So let's just have a quick another discussion about, so now we've gone through quite a lot of some of these examples of what are the types of challenges that people are facing, or we are facing, not just people, but we are all facing in today's world where all of us are connected. And we're using Facebook and mobile phones and things like that. What are we doing to protect ourselves? So what is your security posture? So I'll open up this poll, and then we'll launch into some of the specific things around these in a moment. So let me just ask this question. So basically the question is, what is your security posture, which means some of these practices that are used by as security practices. How many of these, or which of these, do you most recommend that people use or should use? So, for example, using strong passwords, my home location address should not be on Facebook, phone screen password, et cetera. So I think this poll has got a little bit of a limitation at the moment that it's not a multi, what is called a, I can't open it up for everybody to put multiple answers on this right now for some reason, but I can check once again. I'll open this one in a moment, and then you can probably share about a little bit about which are the practices that that you are necessarily not, we are necessarily not following, because these are practices that that are recommended, but some of us sometimes inadvertently forget. So I'm going to open this poll in a moment. So yeah, okay, open the poll. Okay, so I've opened the poll, and if you're able to see, so the question is, what are the types of practices that are least followed in your experience? I'm not necessarily with about by yourself personally, but in your experience, which are these practices are not followed. So these are good practices, and most people should follow them, but there are some people who don't follow them, and we know that. So we've seen cases, and I know personally people in my family, for example, sometimes they don't use strong passwords. They will just use a password like, for example, children's name. And that's not a strong password at all, because children's names are there on Facebook, for example, and things like that. So some people put their location saying, this is my home address, everybody come home for the party, those kind of things, and that's risky. So we'll close the poll in a moment. So we've got about 70-80% responses. If there's any more, then please feel free to input. So what is it that is not followed? What are the responses that are not followed? And I think I'm going to close the poll. So 5, 4, 3, okay, 2, 1. Okay. Now, so the results of the poll, I'll share with everybody. All right, so here it is. So 30% of the people are saying that usually this is the biggest gap. Strong passwords are not used. Then highly personal information is sometimes shared. And then computers and phones are not always updated with the latest software. So these are the key big gaps in practices which I've seen. Home location, that's not a major gap. And then mobile phone lock password, that is something which I think everybody uses anyway, but looks like there are some people who feel that sometimes it's not followed. So that's great. Thank you for the inputs. It is really important. Some of these practices are definitely should be followed. At the same time, what are the other practices that should be followed? So what we'll do is now we are at the 35-minute mark. We'll jump into some of the practices that we should follow as far as our cybersecurity is concerned. So what should we do to prevent such issues from not happening? So here we go. First of all, passwords. Everybody would have heard about this. Passwords are like underpants. Of course, some people also use the word toothbrush, but toothbrush is a little bit less interesting. I think underpants are more interesting. So what should we do with underpants? We change them. And hopefully everybody changes them frequently. Then we keep them private, as in we don't share it with other people. And also we have to keep them adequately clean. For example, what should be the right level of password? So think of your password like your underpants is the message. Keep that in mind, and can share such information with other people as well. If you're telling your, for example, if you're sharing, if you're educating your children about how to make, how to use passwords, then this should be the approach. Now, some more guidance around password. I think everybody knows that passwords should be using several characters like lowercase, uppercase, and numbers, and they should be minimum length should be 8. That is the recommendation these days, is that minimum should be 8. If it's not 8, if your password, any of your passwords, particularly the important ones, if they are not with 8 characters, then you can be in trouble. There have been several studies that have shown that characters less than passwords with less than 8 characters can be easily hacked by tools within few minutes. So very important to keep the password length long, longer the better, but a minimum of 8. And similarly, in the context of what we're calling IoT, in the context of what we're calling automation, in industrial automation, in the context of our own work experiences, it's very important to change the passwords immediately upon installation. So for example, if you have a home router, then at your home, then have you changed the password on the router? If you've not, then it's possible that the username is admin and the password is admin2. And in that case, if you've got, for example, if you're using Airtel or you're using ACT or using BSNL network, as in some of these ISP internet service providers, then what happens is that the person who comes to set up your router when you first subscribe to the service, they would have used the password admin and the user ID admin. And then they can access your router. Now, they could be standing in front of your house one of these days. They could be accessing your router, and they could be easily getting into your router and changing the settings. So if everybody's router has got admin as the admin password, admin user ID, and admin as the password for that user ID, you can imagine how easily anybody's Wi-Fi router can be compromised. And once the Wi-Fi router is compromised, all the traffic, everything, all the emails that you're sending, the internet banking that you're doing, all of that is visible to somebody who can then pass that all of that information to somewhere else as a copy, and they can analyze that information, and everything is visible to the person. So very important that in our homes, in our organizations where we work, we make sure that whenever a device that is on the internet is connected, it could be your the CCTV as well, then the password on that, the admin password particularly, should be changed. And it should be changed to something which has got a strong ability to withstand. So it should be 8 characters if it's possible in that device, and it should be all these characteristics, which is lower, uppercase, etc. Very, very critical. Today, everything is connected. There's so many other devices that are home that are connected. And if you not change the passwords on those, then we are leaving them open for anybody to come and attack. So passwords in the context of our home automation, in the context of IoT, is the first line of defense, the most critical thing. So let's keep that in mind. We're going to go to the next page, which we'll discuss the mobile phone. So clearly, there needs to be a lock on our mobile phones. If you've not done that, and ideally, we should have six numbers, not just the 4 numbers, because it's much easier to break into 4 numbers. It's much easier to guess it. So that's the other thing. Of course, there's a lot of discussion around how do we connect our devices. So, for example, sometimes I leave my Bluetooth open on my phone. Now, that means that my phone is available to anybody is within the 10 feet vicinity to connect to my phone, and it's not very difficult to break into Bluetooth. As we know, there are some software available to do that. So wherever Bluetooth is not required, it is best to switch it off, because that just reduces the amount of visibility that people have into your system. Once they hack into your phone, then they can get a lot of information out, as we know. Wi-Fi. So we are all used to using Wi-Fi in open hotspots, for example, at the airports, or even these days, the cities are giving Wi-Fi. Now, clearly, as we know, Wi-Fi has got a vulnerability, as in people can hack into Wi-Fi. There is technically, it's not possible at the moment to secure Wi-Fi that easily, or most of the Wi-Fis that are available, a hacker can easily tap into it and see all the information that is going through it. So when we are using public Wi-Fi systems, we should not do banking transactions, for example. We should not send critical information through it. We should not try to log into our office systems and emails using that, unless there's a VPN involved in it. So very, very careful. We have to be very careful when we are using public Wi-Fi. So I think all of these things most of us know, but it's good to just remember them. Fingerprint. This is a controversial topic. So, for example, many of these days phones are coming with fingerprint readers, and we just put the fingerprint in, and within like nanoseconds, the phone opens up. There are people who believe, the security experts who believe, that this is not a secure way of using your phone, particularly because your fingerprint can then be stolen by people. So your fingerprint is something biometrics, for example, which Aadhaar uses as well, are not replaceable. If somebody gets to know my password, I can replace the password. However, if somebody steals my fingerprints, there is no way I can replace that information. And once they have all my 10 fingerprints, they have my iris scan, they can use that information for many different purposes, as we can well imagine. So personally, this is not an official discussion, but personally, if you'd ask me, I would recommend not to use fingerprints for authentication purposes for phones, for example, because it's easy to then get a copy of your fingerprint, and that can be misused in many different ways. So that would be a strong recommendation from my end, but we can discuss that a little bit if there's somebody who's interested. Now, the next piece is around social media. So all these things that we're talking about, we should not put this information on social media. We have LinkedIn accounts, for example. We put our telephone numbers there, which is to some extent not that secret these days. Home addresses are not secret, but at the same time, it should not be available to everybody because they can then use it for killing us. More importantly, work information. So, for example, if I'm using LinkedIn and I'm putting information about, hey, here is how I'm doing work at my workplace. I'm working on this project, and this is an interesting project. It turns out that a competitor gets to know about that, and that's bad. Also, at the same time, some hacker can learn about projects that are going on, and that can be dangerous. So for as far as work is concerned, very important not to put any information about your work, very limited about your work, on these social media sites, particularly LinkedIn, because that's where we put most of the work information. I won't go on all of these things, but vacation plans are something that are that make us vulnerable. People know that we are not at home, and then people can just do a physical break into our house because they know that this guy is off for the whole week. So they have the whole week to break into our homes. So some of these things are obviously very, commonsensical. So as long as we use common sense, as long as we keep security practices in mind, which we would do anyway, then we will be safe. So I'll move on quickly to the next piece, which is around emails. So there are two aspects to email. One is that think about email as an open postcard. So if you feel that I'm sending some secret information on email, it's not secret. Google knows everything about our emails. People can easily read and know what we've sent by email. So use an email. I think we should use emails very carefully, not share sensitive information by email. If we want to share by email, then we should perhaps break it up into 3-4 emails, or send half. If you're sending a password, for example, then don't send the user ID along with it. Just send the user ID as an SMS and the password as email. That can break up the two things, and somebody who's hacking into your email will not be able to know both the things. So email, remember, it's like an open postcard. Anybody can read it. And people read your emails, whether you like it or not. There'll be people reading your emails all the time. The next thing is that there's something called phishing. I think everybody knows that we get emails like this from Reserve Bank of India, apparently. And then when we click on, hey, this is what Reserve Bank of India wants to do. They want to do a security update, and they want you to click on this email, on this link, to update your information. And then they also have a warning saying that if you don't do this, then you will be seriously inconvenienced. And what happens when we click on it is that they ask us to put all our information, like transaction password, name on the card, etc. And suddenly our information is lost. Now, I think most of the people don't fall for this, but there are some people there are some emails which are less obvious, and we may fall for it. And this is a huge, huge area at the moment. And so we have to be very careful of how we look at emails. We should always check for where the email is coming from. We should always check that there are no links in it, and we're not clicking on the links. I think everybody knows that. Of course, we should always update the antivirus malware on our systems, particularly our laptops. These days, Windows and Macs have very strong built-in antiviruses and malware detection. So less to worry, but as long as we have what is called updated our software. So most important, one of the most important things to remember is that whenever there's a software update which comes on our system, we should always update the software. The primary reason, as we know, why the WannaCry and Petya, or those ransomware attacks happened, and Merck lost $300 million, and many individuals, like I talked about, people who lost thousands of dollars, as well as that hotel in Austria that got all its people locked, all its guests locked out. That was the primary reason, was that the software was not updated. So if we don't update software, then we leave open holes. Microsoft, et cetera, are very, very good at giving updates. And so we should always update our software. The only other thing I wanted to share was that we should keep a copy of our data. Clearly that's without any doubt one of the things that will keep us safe, in the sense that if our laptop is locked or it is lost, then we will be able to back it up again, or we will be able to update that again. So with that, I'll leave you with a couple of thoughts. One was around, these are some of the tips from, and we've got this from New Zealand all the way, one of the countries, small countries, but at the same time, interesting place. They have got this nice summary of what we should do to be safe. So these are some of the pieces, and I think we've reviewed these, all of these at the moment. So for example, we've talked about backup, we've talked about operating system update, antivirus, unique passwords. There's something called two-factor authentication. I think that's the fact that we have to have a password and an OTP or one-time password. Then recovery drives, we've talked about Wi-Fi, we've talked about social media, personal info, et cetera. Okay, so there are some questions coming. We'll carry that question. I'll just close out the discussion with this one last input, which is that there is something called cert.in. This is our Indian government of India. If there's anything that we'd want to know about what's happening in India in terms of cybersecurity, what is the latest, for example, attack for happening, or if there are some latest viruses that you want to know about, or all the incidents that are happening which you need to be aware of. So most important thing, as we know, is around awareness. So we should be aware of what's going on around us, what are the tricks that people are using to break in, and things like that. So as long as we are able to learn more about it, and CertIn is a really good place, a good resource. There's an email that you can subscribe to. They'll keep sending us updates around what's happening. So I'd encourage everybody to have a look at the CertIn portal and subscribe to their email. So with that, there are some questions that are coming up. So first question is around, I think there was a question around industrial automation and IoT, and I think we've talked about some of that. If there's anything specific around that, please let me know. So I think the main thing there is that in the industrial IoT context, there is need for the software and the hardware that is developed to be developed with a view of security. So if you are developing, for example, if you are in the process or in the business of creating IoT devices, for example, if you are in embedded software or if you are creating medical devices, it's important to think about security right up front and not at the end. So that's one. And secondly, always, always change the password the moment that your device is installed. So don't leave the password as password, for example. So that's the one of the kind of, the, as a user as well as a manufacturer, the perspective that we should take around it. And it's not difficult to secure these devices as long as we are sensible. But at the same time, some of these practices need to be followed. Then there are there's a question around data backup. So I think the question is that should we keep the data backup in hard disk? There are various ways in which data backup is done. For example, one could backup with some of the key files that you have, the information that I feel that if I lose that information, then it will be difficult to recreate that. So for example, there are things like, for example, some very precious pictures are there, as well as, for example, there are receipts, for example, that we want to keep, or particularly copies of let's say our access information into or some bank statements and things like that. So all this information, our files, our work files that we have, or our own creative IP or intellectual property that we've created. So all of these things, we want to keep them safe. And so best thing to do is to get an account with one of these cloud services. Like, for example, it could be Microsoft, it could be Google, and they give free data, as in free storage on the cloud. And then we can just synchronize some of those files which are very important to us with that cloud. Yes. It's safe to keep the data in the cloud, because I think that's a big debate that happens, is that is cloud safe? What the security experts today are saying, and it's not me, but many people in the industry are saying, is that all these cloud services, they have very strong basic or standard practices. Now, of course, we have to be careful about how we share some information. So, for example, if I open up, let's say, Google Drive, and then I share that information, then that information can be, for example, I can share information with anybody, and then using that link, they can get access to that folder which I've shared. Ideally, we should set things like time period for which this is shared. It's only shared for 30 days, or it's shared for 15 days, 2 days, or 1 year. After that sharing should stop. So there are some practices that we should follow, which would allow us to share information on the cloud and then close it. At the same time, these cloud services are very, very safe, because they have to have all these security in place much better than what we can ourselves put in place. They understand these things. So I'd always recommend to use all these cloud services. It's easy to replicate, easy to store information, and then they are quite safe, as long as we use these sensible things like keep our password safe and not share indefinitely, for example. There are some other questions here. For example, there's a question around how to detect and mitigate CNC. CNC is, I'm sorry, I might have missed the term. CNC would be, if you can, Ranjit, if you can let me know what CNC means in your mind, because it escapes my understanding right now, but I can answer that question. Command and control. Okay. How do you detect and mitigate command and control? So that DDoS attack that we talked about, presumably that's what you mean. So there are ways of doing that. For example, there are techniques, or there are tools which allow us to understand where the traffic from my system is going. So, for example, if there is my traffic is going from my network, for example, let's say if I have a company network and there are these IoT devices, and I'm afraid that somebody will control all these devices and then use them for bad things. For example, they could use it for cryptojacking as well. So then if the traffic, for example, network traffic is going from my network into a place which it should not be going typically, then I know that there's probably somebody who's taken up the command and control. So that is the primary way in which it is detected. But of course, the other thing is that we should always change passwords. So password changing, there should be a routine every 90 days, passwords that change on these IoT devices. And that way we can protect those devices from command and control as well. And any command and control that is already persistent in that can be mitigated through that as well. I hope that answers the question. I'm happy to pick it up. Okay, so Siva Subramaniam says that the problem with audio. I hope everybody else can hear me. If there's a challenge, please let me know. I'm going to take to the next question. The questions around, okay, can hear, okay. Thank you, Aina. So the next question is, is it advisable to keep logged in always in apps like Gmail and LinkedIn? Of course not. Do not keep yourself logged into anything, because there is always a risk around that. For example, if the device gets lost, then people have access to it. So ideally, because somebody is saying that I've logged into this session from my iPad but not able to listen, can't see the video. Okay. There's no video, so don't worry about the video. As long as you can listen, you can hear, that should be okay. Sushma, are you able to help Lenny with the audio part, if you don't mind? I'll take the next question up. So the question around Gmail, etc. Should we keep logged in? No, don't keep logged in. Of course, it's a work email, then you will keep logged in. But as far as LinkedIn is concerned, what happens is that if you keep logged in, then for example, if somebody takes over your PC, then for example, if somebody attacks and is able to take charge of the PC, they will be able to see everything that is open at the time, and they can access anything on your laptop. So ideally, there's an option in most systems to actually save your password and not just keep logged in all the time. And then that way you can control when you log in and how you log in as well. So to keep that in mind, that keeping it logged in means that there's a risk that somebody, for example, if you leave your laptop open and somebody comes in and they're able to see your laptop, and then they can easily get in and see all the things, and you're away and having a cup of tea, chai pi rahe, and in the meantime, somebody is sitting at a laptop and looking at all your Gmails and your LinkedIn accounts. So then there's some questions around online transactions. So what should we do if transaction is done without our knowledge? Where should we avoid it? I think there's another question around the bank transaction. So the best way to know is that most of the banks will give you an alert when the transaction happens. So that's the best way to keep track. Of course, we should keep looking into our bank statements every month. So if bank statement comes in, we should look at it. It's very important not to leave that away. And then typically you would find that the OTP will be there for most transactions. If the bank, for example, if your bank doesn't have this practice that every time a transaction happens on your account, an OTP should be given to you and you have to key in that OTP. So if bank doesn't have that, then change your bank, because that is one of the most important ways in which safety is ensured. Even if it's a 20 rupee transaction, 100 rupee transaction, there should be an OTP, for example. And if there's no OTP, the transaction shouldn't go through. And if there's a transaction over a certain limit, they should inform you by SMS. So that way you'll keep track of where your account transactions are. I think there's a question around blockchain technology. So blockchain is something which is different. It's emerging, but at the same time, it will have some impact on some parts of security, but the other things like password, etc., will probably not change. Some of these things we have to keep in mind anyway. So I think blockchain and its impact on security are a slightly more detailed topic. So I'll probably not take that right now, if you don't mind. I think it's somebody who's asking. Meera is asking about blockchain technology. So Meera, I do apologize. I think this will be a little bit longer discussion on blockchain. Happy to have a chat about that offline, if you don't mind, because that's something which requires a bit more discussion. I hope that's okay. Now I know that we are at 8 o'clock. So what I'll do is I'll just carry on with the questions. I think there's a poll that I want to do quickly, and then I will close this. We'll just carry on with the questions after that. So then here's a poll. We'll just do a quick poll, if you don't mind, so that we get to see what is it that will here's a poll 2, 3. So I'm going to open up a poll now. So sorry about that. So there is a poll here, which I will come to in a moment. I think it's for some reason it's not coming through. Ah, there it is. So open poll. All right. So I've opened the poll. Now this question is, which of these areas require immediate action for you? So from what we've discussed today, what you think should be an area that you want to get some action done in an early time frame from either the discussion today or from your understanding of where some of the security posture gaps might be. So you can see around halfway mark. You can see that that we're getting more towards the 60% mark, and take about 20 more seconds and we'll close the poll. So we are at about 70% mark. So what's the one area that you think is important for you to think about from your understanding of cybersecurity, either from today's discussion or from your knowledge from other places? So I think we're at about 70% mark, 80% now, and I'm going to take another 10 seconds and then close the poll. So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, close the poll, and poll results I'm going to share with everybody. Yeah. So for some reason, okay, it's collating the responses. It says another 5 seconds to collate the responses. 4, 3, 2, and then we've got the results. There we go. Apply, and hopefully everybody can see the results. So password is the main area, 32%. Social media, there's a spelling error there. Social media, 4%. Email, 8%. Smartphone software updates, 8%. Antivirus, data backup, okay. And few people chose not to answer. So looks like password is an area that everybody wants to think about, which is great. Okay, and obviously I'm going to close the poll now. So obviously the last thing is that if you could give your feedback now. We'll carry on the discussion if people want to hang on. I've got a few questions here which we didn't get addressed. So questions like, for example, what happens if the cell phone is lost? So and the data is and we've got some always on LinkedIn apps like Gmail, LinkedIn. I mean, that's a very risky situation, and there are some ways in which you can wipe out your phone if it is lost remotely. So there are some apps like that, and I think iPhone has got the feature. I think Android has got some apps through which you can actually wipe out. So it's always recommended that apart from a strong password to enter the phone, and also apart from making sure that your phone is encrypted, there's also the third thing is to make sure that you have an app on it so that it can be remote wiped. So the moment it gets connected to the net, somebody connects and they're trying to get to your Gmail, etc., then it will immediately wipe out the phone. So of course there's a big risk that they may not connect to the Gmail, but at the same time they can still look at the messages, which becomes a challenge. Yeah, that's a big area of concern. I think everybody has that. I personally have got that concern as well. So to keep your phone safe, keep it locked, that would be the best thing to do. If it's lost, then try to get it wiped. Of course, most importantly, don't keep such data on the phone that it becomes a challenge for you. So the moment your phone is lost, then you should change your password for Gmail, change your password for LinkedIn, make sure that there's not enough information there. So so then there is another question around what do you recommend in this question around last week one of my friends had to face this. Okay, so what do they do around the phone? So maybe we can chat about that separately if you would like. You know, we can chat about that later on today or tomorrow. What would you recommend, Android or iOS, in terms of security? Obviously iOS is more secure, there's no doubt about it, in the sense that that because there's more control over the apps that are going in there, iOS is more secure. And obviously, I'm sure Google will contest that. But at the same time, Apple takes the security much more seriously. You know that a little bit, at least in terms of the public posturing, we know that they take it more seriously and think they have more control over their ecosystem. So it would be more secure. I think the other question is around ransomware. Will ransomware affect in the cloud service? while syncing the data from laptop. Yes, of course, it will. If the laptop is locked, then there's no question of syncing. But of course, once your data is synced to the cloud, then you have a backup. So then your data is protected. Whatever is in the cloud will be protected. There'll be no ransomware on that. So that way, it's a good thing if you have got, let's say, 50 GB, 100 GB data which is synced in your cloud, that will be safe. And that's a good thing. You can then get on a new laptop or just do an OS operating system reset on your old laptop and just sync the data again, and you're up and running. No ransomware will not be able to trouble you in that situation. Okay, so I think that's it. I think there's a couple of questions like studies. Okay. I think we're pretty good with this. So I think there's some questions which I think we couldn't get to, like blockchain, and I think there's probably some discussion around what happens if a phone is lost and things are not wiped out. So we can pick that up in another discussion if you want more details. So we are at almost 10 minutes past 8. So I think that's the main thing. I think also I've got a response from Aina here saying that the malware attacks are more on open source. Apple has got lesser attacks, iOS as well as iMac, but Windows and Windows for PC as well as Android have got more malware as a percentage attacking them because of the sheer volume of people who use it. There's more attacks on that. Plus, there's probably something to do with also the security around it. Okay. So with that, we'll stop now. If there are any other questions, please do feel free to email me. Happy to take them online, offline. And thank you very much for joining the session today. I hope there's some action that you got that you can take up from there. That was one of the key objectives, was to kind of give you a sense of what is it that you want to do next in terms of getting a better security for yourselves as well as your loved ones. Stay safe. All of us, we have to be sensible, and we have to look out for each other and make sure that all of us are safe. Thank you very much. Have a lovely evening that's ahead of you, and speak to you again. Thank you.
Thank you, Alok sir, for a wonderful webinar. I hope most of us will now start not using the same password for all the things. And I hope most of our participants would have learned what are most of the things for the cybersecurity. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for giving us a wonderful webinar. Yeah. And for all the participants, there is one feedback form I just sent. So you can just fill that up. It really helps us to improve our content or the webinar or something. Yeah. Thanks a lot, sir, once again. Yeah.